funny, and it's not the typical Indian English. But one thing that I did notice in 1980 when I came back to India, to my own home country, is the fact that whenever you put four Indians together, there are few popular and a common topic to discuss. The first and foremost topic is what a horrible country we are all living in, how the government is failing everyone, how the society is going down the hill. The second topic is, of course, the working of our government. We all like to believe that we can advise the Prime Minister how to run the government, although we are unable to run our own homes and our own lives. But we take it for granted that we are so brilliant to tell the Honorable the Prime Minister and His Excellency the President, or even the Honorable the CM of the state, how to run the state or the country. And lastly, we talk about our own problems of our own lives. But let me tell you, all these topics are not something unique to our country or to our age. If you turn back the pages of history, you'll find that in Iraq, about 5,000 years ago in the Mesopotamian civilization, we actually found a tablet written in their language called the cuneiform. And it's a very interesting tablet to read. And it says, the king is blind, he's deaf and dumb. The ministers are cheating the king. They're leading the empire of the Mesopotamians, of the Babylonians, into a dark alley. These are the days when the children do not listen to their parents. They do whatever they please. Brothers fighting against brothers, sisters fighting against brothers. Husband and wife can't get along. The wife is always complaining about the husband and vice versa. Dark are the days, even the gods have left us, they've abandoned us. This has been what we have sung as human beings for the last 5,000 years. And let me assure you, none of it is true. For 5,000 years, in fact for 1 lakh years, human beings as a species have survived through the rough and tough, through the hills and valleys of the planet Earth, and we continue to thrive. And if you look and read books like Abundance, you'll realize that perhaps we are living in the most golden age and era that our species ever lived in. And look around you. See how lucky all of you are. You are educated. Half the world is uneducated. It is illiterate. Consider yourself lucky because you are the elite of this greatest democracy and the largest democracy in the world. Just look around your neighborhood. Look at Pakistan, look at Bangladesh, look at Nepal, look at Bhutan, look at Sri Lanka. Look at the countries of Africa. Where are they? In 70 years, we have achieved what none of those countries who became independent with us could possibly achieve. We are putting our satellites out into the orbit, and you have something in your hand, and let me share something about this, what you these days, you all of us hold in our hand, called the cell phone. In 1977, there was a friend of my father who came to our house for dinner. He was the president of the Comcast company, the largest company that began laying their cables for cable TVs. And in 1977, at this dinner, he told us that, you know, someday you'll have a small phone in your palm of your hand and you will be able to do your shopping, your banking. You'll in fact be able to see the person to whom you'll be talking across the world. When he left, all three of us, I and my two brothers, turned to our father and we said, ye aadmi thoda khiska hua hai, pagal khane le jao. We all wondered, what was he talking about? He said you could see a person across the world to whom you were talking to. So we asked our father, aapka jo dost hai na, bilkul hi pagal hai. Wahan koi camera leke khada hoga jo tasveer utarega. We could not imagine even shopping. How can you shop when you don't see your consignment or your artifacts that you'll be buying? And lo and behold, today all of you do half your shopping through a mobile phone. Today all of us do FaceTime. My daughter, who is in America, I can speak to her, and I can actually see how dirty her apartment is and remind her, please clean up your apartment. That is what technology has done. You and I'm sure you will live longer than your grandparents ever imagined that they will live. I'm sure you will have better facilities in your lives than we have had in ours. The things that your family owns or you will own in your life will be far greater than what your grandparents could even imagine. Ask your grandparents, when was the first time they bought a fridge? When was the first time they had a telephone? Therefore, rejoice in the fact that you're living in one of the finest countries and certainly one of the finest states of the Union of India. While we are grateful to those who have built our state and our country, we should also realize one thing. We in Telangana happen to be the youngest state in the Union of India. It is a state that was born after struggle for 14 years, a state that had sacrificed its people, its interest. We stood for our rights, we fought for our rights, and we have triumphed. Therefore, the responsibility is on each one of us to make this state the biggest, the best, and the brightest state in India. And let us not forget while we march in our life that this is the solemn responsibility that we have taken upon our own shoulders to fulfill. Let me now talk about another thing. It is something that I'm sure all of you are experiencing. Certainly I experienced when I left the United States in 1980. Away from the shadows of my parents, and like any Indian parents, they can be over-domineering. They can start dictating the slightest thing in our lives, and therefore when we leave the shadows of our parents and we go to another city, to another country, we say what I once said to my mother as she was leaving for college. My mother used to be a lecturer. At the age of 7, when I saw that my mother was leaving for her college, I shouted, "Swatantrata, Swatantrata." It was another thing that by the time she came in the evening, the first thing I got was a thrashing from my mother for having declared my liberation from her rule. But this is exactly what we feel like when we leave our homes. I'm sure half of you have a sigh of relief that, thank God, the father is not telling you what to wear and what not to wear. I tried my level best to convince my daughter to wear proper clothes, something that we had a battle over every day in the morning. Therefore, when we enter the college, we are in a very exuberant mood. We are in mood of celebration. We want to celebrate our freedom. And it is that sense that we feel that we are liberated, that we can actually do what we want to do. And youth is always, throughout history, throughout the world, the youth is always experimental. It wants to try the latest thing, the latest gadgets, see the latest films, wear the latest clothes, and it is this that takes us, I would not say into a wrong path, but certainly takes us into a path which I call the slippery slope. It is a path which is riddled with difficulties, not for yourself, but also for others. Many of us tend to blame the life that we are leading. We have certain high expectations of ourselves, of our people. We also realize as the youth that we have to come up to the expectations of our parents, and we realize that perhaps we are not anywhere close to our own expectations of who we should be and what we are. And then we start blaming life itself. And when we grow up with a lot of tension, and there is a lot of tension these days because there's higher level of competition, there's higher level of expectation from all of you, we realize that life has slowly started turning into a burden. And that is when we take to something that even my children tell me, that most of the people in the college think that, yes, if I take to alcohol, to substance abuse, perhaps I'll get a relief. And I'm told, although I do not know, I have no personal experience, but I'm told that once you enter that alley called the alley of the substance abuse, initially it does give you a thrill, it does give you relief, but it's a very temporary relief. It is the same relief that I presume that one you would get from a fragrance. That fragrance and that exuberation lasts you not more than an hour. And unfortunately what happens is that slowly but surely what began as an experiment that becomes our path to our extermination. Therefore what happens is, number one, we start destroying our mind, our body. We end up into a craving thing, and I can assure you it is something that even I would know, because people of my generation, we are all addicted to something called tea and coffees. Deprive us of our tea and coffee, by the evening time we are ready to fight with everyone in our homes, certainly ready to fight with our wife, certainly ready to fight with our lawyers, because we are in need of caffeine at that time. Therefore it becomes a dangerous path for all of us. And look at the consequences that will begin to happen. The consequences are not only that it adversely affects your brain and mind, most importantly, it begins to disrupt your family pattern. It begins to affect those who are around you. If you're the eldest in the family, you're the role model for the younger siblings, and the younger sibling starts wondering whether you really deserve the respect that he has been paying you for all his life. If you're the youngest in the family, the mother begins to wonder whether you should continue to be loved and pampered as you were for all these years. Slowly it will start, and it's a cancerous growth that will eat into the entrails of your family happiness. And then it will start affecting your neighborhood. Before you know it, it will start affecting your city. Because those who are used to drug abuse need the money, need the space, need the privacy from the prying eyes of the police, from the prying eyes of the parents, of their own friends, their own colleagues. And what began, what you thought began as a beautiful dream of escape, starts turning into a nightmare. A nightmare where you will find it very difficult to get yourself out of. Therefore, please remember what the Greeks used to say. The Greeks had a saying which said, a strong mind, a strong body. And this is exactly what our ancient culture taught us. When we taught our children, Aham Brahmasmi, or what the Holy Quran says, that we are the children of Allah the Great. Please remember that all of you have a divine light inside you. It is a divine light given to you, not by your parents, not by your school, perhaps not even by the college that you are attending. It is a divine light given by the Almighty, and He is the director of every film. He assigns us a role that we are duty bound to carry out, and I can assure you, He has already thought of the place where you will reach someday. Let me just share an experience with you. In 1980, when I came back to this country, hoping that I'll study law, and I did, and then I eventually became a lawyer. In the initial days, the life of a lawyer is a life of a struggle, of hardship, for the simple reason, when you have black hair and you look young, nobody brings you important cases. And especially if you're from outside, as I was an alien in my own home country, nobody would come to my doors. And at that time, in the darkest hours of the night, I would wonder, why has God brought me from United States, where I had my family, my friends, family, and hearth and home, and why has He brought me to India? There must be some logic as to why I have fallen from what at that time looked like the golden country with the sparkling gold roads and buildings, to a country which was infested with malaria at that time, a country which was known as a third world country. And for 25 years, this question kept on drinking me. What am I doing here? Perhaps I took a wrong turn in my life. And I'm sure this is a question that all of you will struggle as you grow up, as you get a job, you get married, you have children, you have homes, you have neighbors who are constantly fighting with you, you have a boss whom you would rather get rid of, but you can't. But let me tell you, there's always a purpose in life. Even when we think that our gods have abandoned us, they have not abandoned us. They merely test us to see our faith, to see our steadfastness, to see our tenacity towards life. And all of you, for all of you, there is a divine plan. Therefore, do not have any doubts on that Almighty. The day my Chief Justice called me to his bungalow and he said, "Mr. Chauhan, we are sending your name for elevation as a judge." I told him, I said, "Sir, for 25 years I have struggled with this issue. Why am I here? Perhaps that is what the destiny wanted me to do, to serve my own people, to build my own country, to help my own people, and to get rid of the pains and agonies. Perhaps that is the job that God has assigned me." I can assure you, all of you have jobs that God will have assigned you. The only thing is, your assignment is unknown to you. Many of you will become lawyers, many of you become engineers, many of you will become doctors, many of you will become our parliamentarians, our MLAs. We do not know, but perhaps in this August House, we even may have a Nobel laureate. I'm sure when Amritin Sen was being taught in Calcutta University, nobody knew that they were teaching a Nobel laureate. Therefore, all I can say is, as you leave your colleges, please remember what the Chinese say, that an education institution arms you with two candles in both your hands. Carry these candles, and you can be assured that neither there will be darkness in your own life, nor in the life of this state or our nation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Milad. Thank you for your Milad Srinivasan inspiring speech about the family, relationship and Almighty. Thank you, Milad. Now, announcement of anti-drug club, abuse club by Honorable Chief Justice. Now,
I must say this thing looks like more like reading a farman. The Anti-Drug Abuse Club consists of the Honorary President, Mr. Mahesh Bhagwat, the Commissioner of Police, Rachakonda, the Working President, Srimati C. Sumanlata, Chief Judge, City Civil Court, Hyderabad. Secretary, Mr. D. Venkatesh, Secretary, District Legal Service Authority. The Joint Secretary, Mr. D. Jagdishwar Rao, President, Bar Association, City Civil Courts. My best wishes to all of you. I hope you will succeed and save the youth of our state. Thank you.
Thank you, Milad. Thank you. Now, presentation of books as a token of respect to Honorable Chief Justice and also Honorable Justice M.S. Ramchandra Rao garu by Srimati C. Sumalata, Chief Judge. Quickly, please speak. Presentation of books also to Mahesh Bhagwat ji, aapko bhi, Waliullah ji, Muhammad Waliullah ji, the vice chairman, on behalf of Khan Latif Khan, chairman of the society, and the editor, Munfiz Daily. Please click. Now, felicitation and presentations by Bar Association City Civil Courts Hyderabad. President and this Executive Committee. Please click, sir, click. Now quick. Okay, so now I think that's Jelly Shirkar. Now what of thanks? Momento to Madam Sumlata Garu by Bar President Bar Association. Momento to G.V. Subramanian Garu by President Bar Association. Right on. Now, now moment out to Ms. Bhagwat Garu by Bar Association President and also Waliullah Garu. Now, out of thanks by Sri S. N. Sridevi, 9th Additional Chief Judge, City Civil Courts.
Honorable the Chief Justice Raghavendra S. Chavan, sir. The Patron-in-Chief, State Legal Services Authority, Honorable Sri Justice M.S. Ramchandra Rao sir, the Executive Chairman, State Legal Services Authority, Honored Member Secretary, State Legal Services, G.V. Subramaniam sir, equally honored Chief Judge Sumalata, the Bar President Jagadeswar Rao, the dignitaries of the dais, the resource persons Mahesh Bhagavat, Commissioner of Police Rachakunda, Dr. Devika Rani, founder Amruta Foundations, my colleague Pattabhi Ramarao, who will all be sharing the roles played by their respective wings in dealing with the drug addicts, drug abuse, all the judicial officers, participants, invitees, people from the fourth estate, a very good morning to all of you. Indeed, it's a proud moment for me to propose this Thanksgiving. I, on behalf of all the judicial officers and the entire fraternity of the City Civil Courts Legal Services present here today, and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to everyone present here, and more importantly, their lordships, for taking their time from their respective schedules to grace this august occasion. I also extend my sincere thanks to all the students, staff, the college management for their enormous cooperation in organizing this program. I once again state that we are all most grateful to you all. I thank you all for being with us this morning. Thank you very much.
Now, please stand up for national anthem.
जनगण मन अधिनायक जय है भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंधु गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ उत्कल वंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभाशिष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगलदायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे जय हिंद.
Now the dignitaries will leave the dais and the students will remain here for academic sessions, including other office, judicial officers also. Right.
All students are requested to remain present in the hall.
Within 10 minutes, academic sessions will start. Please keep silence, please keep silence, please take your seats. Please take your seats. Program is not over, program will continue till lunch. Right? Till lunch. There are academic, good academic sessions.